I'm really pleased to introduce the next speaker, who's a great friend of entrepreneurs in the United Kingdom in particular. He's been a superb friend to me and one of our founding shareholders at Viva Investment Partners. His introductions are just always so exactly what we need. It's crazy. He introduced us to Vashi Dominguez, who was on stage as our opening keynote speaker. Yesterday morning, everybody was impressed with Vashi. It's one of the most important entrepreneurs that we've ever worked with, that I've ever worked with and known. And Michael is like that. He tends to do things in a very considered, precise way, and then it just kind of goes to the bullseye of what you're trying to achieve, or the problem that you're trying to solve, or the dragon that you're trying to slay. He's an incredibly good advisor, and also just nearly a genius in terms of the way that he unlocks brands. Many of you will know the Mandarin Oriental, she's a fan, he's a fan. This is the man who made that happen. Would you please bring Michael Moszynski to the floor to talk about the future of his industry? Thank you so much, Michael.
Thank you, Julie, and great to see everyone. What I'm going to talk about is something I think that's very relevant to you. It's the case of how advertising can help turn a startup into an acorn, unicorn. It's something I hopefully know a little about, because over the course of my career, I've helped 5 startups become unicorns. And hopefully with Vashi, as pointed out in Forbes in May of this year, he's forecast to be one of the next 15 UK unicorns. So if you're a startup or an investor, I hope this presentation is going to be relevant to you. Now, you all think that you're sitting here on the second afternoon of the conference and see how things go. But actually, I'm not going to do all the work. I'm going to get you to do some of the work. Now, you may know this visual from Wolves of Wall Street. I'm not going to get you to come up here and sell me this pen, but everyone has one of these in front of you. I will ask you now to pick it up, because you are going to play but in this game, there's no conferring, there's no phone a friend, but I am going to make the questions easier by giving you 50-50 on each of the next 5 questions. So, are you ready? Let's play Who Wants to Be a Billionaire? Okay, question 1 for $1,000. True or false? So you need to write down one word, true or false. Differentiating a brand is a key marketing task. Okay. Have you all answered that question? For $1,000? If you've written true, I'm sorry, you're out of the game. The next question. For $64,000, true or false? Keeping an existing customer is cheaper than acquiring a new one. True or false? Sorry if you wrote in true. It's a myth. You're out of the game. For $250,000, true or false? Price promotions reward existing customers rather than gain new ones. Price promotions reward existing customers rather than gain new ones. That's true. Right. For $1 million. Sure, you're all keen to know that the answer is indeed false. Right, I'm not sure how many people are still left in this game, but for $1 billion,
or false? Broadcast media with high wastage helps a brand grow more cost efficiently than targeted media with low wastage. Broadcast media with high wastage helps a brand grow more cost efficiently than targeted media with low wastage. And the answer is... it's true. So, hands up, everyone who got all five answers correctly. That is a great shame, because I have in my pocket a check for $1 billion. I'm glad I don't have to honour that one. So, I'm not going to actually go through why all of those myths are myths. If you want to find out the answer, you can get this book on Amazon. It's by Byron Sharp, which has done, he's a professor in marketing. He's done an analysis, quantifiable analysis of over 3,000 companies, and he explains why in that book those myths exist and why they're not true, or why they are true. You don't need to go and read the book, because what I've asked Daniel to do is give everyone here a 45-slide synopsis of that book. So you'll get that later on today, and that will help explain why some of those myths exist. The biggest problem today, I think, is that according to Yankovic, each of us are targeted by 10,000 paid-for messages a day. 10,000. I'm going to ask you to think about one you can remember from yesterday. It's hard. So the reason I think advertising is so important for a startup is because when you start with a business plan, all it is an Excel sheet. The only way that business plan actually is made to happen is changing the attitudes and behavior of people. And that's true for a business-to-business brand as it is for a consumer brand. So to do that journey from startup to unicorn, you've got to use methods to impact people's attitudes and behavior. And advertising is one of the strongest ways of doing that. That's the good news. The bad news is that over the last few decades, only 8% of advertising is correctly recalled. That means that you notice the ad, but you also remember the brand it was from. I mean, I'm sure you've all gone back into the office, remember those days, where you actually hear people say, "Oh, I saw a great ad on the telly last night. Trouble is, I can't remember who it's for." And too many advertising agencies think they are in the entertainment business. No, our job is we're in the sales business. We're selling people's brands, we're selling people's products. And I think that is a disgusting slide. Absolutely, my entire career is dedicated to doing the opposite of that. Because that's an average, 8%. That means 92% of the money that clients spend on advertising is poured down the drain. Can you, as financial people, ever imagine recommending to somebody to spend an investment where 92% of it is wasted? So what I'm going to talk about is how to not be in the average, and that's an average. So some of the advertising has got 0%. So there are some guidelines I can give you on that, which I'm going to go through. And the answer to that problem is to be brilliant, which is also very convenient because it's our company motto. And you ask, what is brilliant? Well, I'm pleased to say we have an equation for that. And the equation is intelligence times magic equals brilliant. It's a mathematical formula, guaranteed to work. So let me explain why. So intelligence is actually defined in two ways, intellect and information. And intellect comes from experience. So if you've got a lot of experience, you can have a hypothesis, you can have a gut feel, and you can actually do advertising entirely based on intellect. The other way to do it is also to use information. And we all know about how much data is being collected today. So the more data you can get, the more you can actually back up your hypothesis that you came up with your intellect. So the real answer is to use both. Now, what's magic? where does magic come from and how do we find it? This is the challenging part because nobody knows. But it has to be found. There has to be a light bulb moment, a eureka. To turn intelligence into brilliant, there has to be a bit of magic. Now, you may know that the consultancy firms like McKinsey, Deloitte are buying their way into advertising to process all of the data-driven solutions that we all know and love. But what they can't do is that bit of magic because they don't have the creativity. And it's the creativity that pulls the rabbit out of the hat. And I've been incredibly fortunate to work with my creative partner, Alan Jarvie, for almost 30 years. And he pulls rabbits out of the hat every day, and he's brilliant at it. And I'm going to show you a few examples. But the way I'm going to do that is by answering this question, because if you're doing advertising already, you may well have brilliant advertising. But here is a very simple checklist to answer the question, to find out if your advertising is brilliant. Is it simple? Will it stand out? And will people remember who it's for? And you can all do that on any piece of communication because it has to answer all those three questions. I'm going to go through each one in a bit of detail. Firstly, is it simple? This was a strategy. We heard earlier yesterday about how the highest investment ever made into a single project was the project to take a man to the moon and return him safely to Earth. And that was how President Kennedy articulated it in 1961. And we all know that in July 1969, before the decade was out, they put a man on the moon and returned him safely to Earth. And what I like about that is it is such a simple, clear message. And somebody also said that any mission of an organization has to be understood by everyone who is employed by it. And that's why this picture is so important. So in about 1965, some people from Harvard were doing a time motion study, and they went around and interviewed all the members of staff from NASA. And they came across a janitor cleaning the loos. And they came up to him with their clipboard and said, "Excuse me, sir, can you tell us what your job is?" Put his mop down, leant on it, and said, "I'm helping send a man to the moon." So that was a great example of a very simple strategy. Here's another one. A few years ago, Sainsbury's, which is a major food retailer in the UK, needed to increase their sales by 2.5 billion over 3 years. Now, the usual thing to do would be to, you know, create a plan to attack your nearest competitor, Tesco's, and try and attract their customers out to them. But their simple strategy was to say, if we increase the basket size of every customer by £1.40, we would achieve that goal. So their communication was also very simple, and it was try something new today. And that worked in advertising, worked at point of sale, it gave each department head, whether it's in poultry, vegetables, whatever, a very clear strategy to work to, and new ideas, new products, introducing avocados, whatever. So that allowed them to achieve their goal within the deadline that they had set themselves. Very simple. Now, this is an example I work with. This gentleman is called Dr. Mike Adenuga. He's a Nigerian entrepreneur, and we were invited by him to go to Lagos to help him launch his new mobile phone company. And when we arrived, there were 36 people sitting around the conference table, and we were treated to a four-hour presentation by Design IG, the international design agency, on the brand structure and all of the brand identity, from everything from the SIM cards all the way through to the frontage of the shops. And this is what we saw. So the company was called Globacom, and they had a number of products that each had their own name, their own logo, and different colors. And after the end of this four-hour presentation, Dr. Mike turned around to me and said, "Well, Mr. Moszynski, you come all the way from London. What do you think of all of these?" And I said, it's going to be very expensive to advertise. He said, what do you mean? I said, well, you've got seven brands there. So you're going to have to spend seven times more investing meaning in each of those entities. And then I pointed out that if you look around internationally, telecoms, which is an invisible, intangible product, tend to have what's called a monolithic brand, one brand name. Anyway, this then resulted in a seven-hour debate. Because let's face it, Nigerians are not known for their shortness of words. So at the end of that debate, my creative partner, Alan, who'd had his head in his lap, sort of perked up and said, look, you know, you like this thing called Yo, it's sort of young and friendly and accessible. And also, why have you got all these different colors? And they said, well, some of us like blue and some of us like red. And he said, well, look, your vision was to be a Nigerian brand that Nigerians could be proud of because it would be world class. That's what they want, that's what the founder wanted the company to stand for. So he said, look, why don't we shorten your name and use your national colors? And he came up with that in the first meeting. And it suddenly simplified everything. And we did an advertising campaign based on the theme Glow with Pride. It's simple, it stands out, and guess what? You can remember who the brand is. And what no one told us at the time of that debate and why the Nigerians were arguing against us so intently was that that day in Lagos Bay was a container ship containing all of the store point of sale, frontage, all of the design items based on that previous design identity. We didn't know that. And the chairman, by agreeing to our recommendation, sent $30 million worth of design materials to be recycled. So he understood that the benefit of simplicity was worth wasting $30 million that had already been spent. What it also delivered for him was a brand that within the first week of launch had 84% awareness and is now one of the largest companies in Africa. In fact, he was yesterday signing a deal with the French president to do a deal across satellites across Africa. So simplicity is really, really important. And it starts with the brand name. So the second test is, does it stand out? This is an example in architecture. There are thousands of buildings in London, and the Shard literally sticks out. This is an example in advertising of literally sticking out. It's a great ad for epoxy adhesive, and the understatedness of the line with a real car that was stuck on the poster using that glue made the point very firmly. But there's lots of other ways to make things stand out. And one of the simplest is to do the opposite of what everyone else is doing. And that, at the start of our process, we get all of the competitor advertising and pin it up on a wall and see what it is. Now, I think a few people know a bit about watch brands in this room. Actually, I'm not going to talk about watch brands yet. This is Carl Nolet Sr. He was an entrepreneur from Holland who had a vodka called Kettle One. And he had sent his son to get people to taste it and get some people to talk about it in America. So he'd built his distribution and his initial sales all through word of mouth. And as I said earlier, word of mouth is the best form of advertising. But he knew that if he wanted to achieve his goal to become a unicorn, he needed to scale that much more rapidly. And that's what advertising can do. It can be like adding fuel to the fire. So he was desperately unsure about advertising because the last thing he wanted to do was turn off those who had found the brand for themselves. And Alan showed him this ad. Dear Kettle One drinker, thank you. So the simple strategy was rather than aim the advertising at non-drinkers, aim it at those who already were drinking it, and in this case, to simply thank them. And you can see how that stood out against everyone else in the category. It's one of the most misogynistic and outdated types of advertising you could ever imagine. And the second type of advertising for vodka is just a pack shot. So no photography, no pack shot, just a bit of type. And that helped him sell to Diageo for $1 billion. 7 years later, after $35 million of buying media space. So if you have something simple and it stands out and you remember the name, you can actually do better than the competition. This is another example. Edward Melon, his family bought an old Swiss watch brand called H. Moser. They only make 1,500 watches a year. And our strategy for them was that H. Moser watches are very rare. Now, in the competitive environment, the creativity to design a watch ad is, you know, you can just imagine the meetings between the client and the agency. Well, we're going to get so-and-so, and we're going to get him to hold his watch like this rather than like that. You know, so what you see here is advertising for the category, not for the brand. Our solution was to make a virtue of it. H. Moser watches, so rare, they don't even appear in H. Moser watch advertisements. And that stood out, and people remembered who it's from. So the final question is, will people remember who it's for? Does everyone know this? Fearless Girl in Wall Street in Manhattan. It won every single advertising award going. There's a problem, though. No one knows the brand who did it, apart from the people who did it, a few others. So we call that Pointless Girl. So it's all very well and good, you know, the advertising industry patting them on the back, but actually it does nothing for the brand. Whereas an apple for apple, it's not clever, but it is brilliant, because we all see that. We don't even need to see the words. We all know what that brand is for. This is a gentleman called David Scrivens, and he came to us during COVID. He had an ambition. His vision was to create an ethical investment fund that would not just talk to the people already in that sector in the financial industry, but to reach a much wider population, a much wider public. And he said to us, this is the name of the brand, High Impact Investor. He said, everything's up for grabs. You can do whatever you want, but it took us 9 months to agree on that name, to be able to register it, find the .com. So we don't want a new name. We just want you to advertise that. And again, Alan said, well, the problem is no one knows what impact investing is. That was from intellect. That was a gut feel judgment. We then did research, and it actually showed that 90% of the public don't know what impact investing is. So we used research to validate the instinct. So what Alan said is, you want to create a company that's only going to invest in companies that do good. So that's what we called the company. We only invest in companies that do good, and this is the TV ad.
Duguud only invests in companies that do good.
That's what the website looks like. That's what the poster looks like. It's not particularly creative, but it is brilliant because you can see it standing out. It's very simple, and you can remember the brand. So those are the three questions you should always ask. And if you think I'm going to stand up here and lecture you on what to do for your brand and don't do it for myself, I would be a hypocrite. So during COVID, we, a bit like Vashi, we suffered 80% downturn in revenue because a lot of our clients were involved in international travel. And we had a bit of cash flow in the bank. And we said, well, let's chuck it all on red. So we invested it in this.
advertising agency launching a new advertising campaign is nothing new, but it is when the campaign is for a rather unusual client themselves. London Advertising has launched adverts on billboards and TV, including voiceovers by Liam Neeson and Helen Mirren.
We believe if you advertise through a crisis or recession, when your competitors aren't spending, you will gain market share. That's why London Advertising is advertising.
Michael, good to see you. Few agencies advertise themselves in this way. What made you think of the idea?
Well, it's been proven by a lot of industry research projects that the businesses that continue to advertise in a downturn can actually generate increases in market share versus those who don't. And given that that's what we advise our clients, we thought it's actually a good time for us to take our own medicine. London is drowning.
When the London advertising campaign broke, I had to smile almost to myself, because here was an example of an advertising agency doing what most advertising agencies should be telling their clients to do. You know, I had a pat on the back, as far as I'm concerned.
I was absolutely stopped in my tracks. In fact, I got off my bike and took a photograph of the ads. Brilliant use of outdoor.
When you're an agency that uses advertising, believe me, for some crazy reason, you are unignorable. Nuclear error, but I have no fear, because London is drowning. And London figured out that television and outdoor are the fastest way to generate awareness, and they're right.
How many advertising agencies can you name? Well, now you can name one more.
London Advertising's awareness is more than 6 times as high as awareness of some other ostensibly much more well-established advertising agencies. And among the key sub-demographic group of consumer opinion influencers, people whose views other people kind of listen to and are guided by, awareness of London Advertising went up even more.
Does advertising work? We'll find out.
Excellent. Absolutely fantastic. Those are great. It's always fun to have you on stage. and you're working with Vashi as well, so you're advising him on his brand. That's quite something. What is it like to take hold of something like that and to work with him to build, to continue to develop that brand? What does that feel like?
What I love is finding interesting people who have big ideas, and as you saw from his own presentation, the energy and excitement to deliver on them. Because what I was taught in my first job for Saatchi & Saatchi was that there are two things that you need to have. One is a great idea, and the second part is the ability to make it happen. And I've been very fortunate that my creative partner has the brilliant ideas, and as a partnership, I sort of help make them happen.
Fantastic. Another one, and I saw the logo there of Roxy. Tell us a little bit about Roxy, because that's a special entrepreneur and a special opportunity there with the Sky brand and so forth. What have you helped to do for that?
Roxy is a music streaming service through your television. Originally, it was actually as a sort of box that you plugged in. And the first time I met the CEO and the entrepreneur who set it up, he did a brilliant job in negotiating all of the contracts with the record labels to facilitate that business. So, well, what if you could fit the product into the televisions when they're shipped, which is how, you know, Microsoft, you know, grew Explorer. So it's fitted in the PCs before you get them on your desk. And he then went off and found a solution to that. Mm-hmm. And so, yes, we produced a TV ad with Kylie Minogue during COVID, which was
fun.
Yeah, fun. Challenging. And it helped him secure his next round of funding, and we found the chairman for him. It's all through this network that Julie has so beautifully curated.
Well, no, I think we're co-creating it. It's fun. Any questions for Michael? Any questions? So we got Simon over there. Simon, can we get the microphone over to Simon, please? Can we get the microphone? Yep. Where's our gentleman with the microphone? Can somebody? Yeah, let's get the microphone over to Simon. Let's make sure that we always have the microphone on the floor when we're doing Q&A.
I forgot my question now.
There's always a troublemaker, just always a troublemaker.
I won't be back next year. Oh, there you go.
Yeah.
So, one of our problems, so we've outsourced to marketing companies over the years so many times, and they did very well, which is why none of you heard of us before we got here. my problem, because your presentation really resonates with me, you know. I think less is more in some cases when it comes to what you're trying to say. My problem's always been the marketing versus PR, and the fact that, you know, if we get a PR agency, they don't seem to do PR, and if we get a marketing agency, they don't seem to do marketing. So, do you guys, as well as marketing, do you help with the PR side of it as well? And everyone knows what I mean by the difference in that, don't they?
Well, that's a very good segue to the next presenter, who's Mark Bukowski. He and I and our two agencies work hand in glove, and we've done some of the work that you saw there for Roxy.
So hold on, your two agencies, one that does marketing, one that does PR, we decided to work together.
We are a creative agency. We come up with strategies and ideas and make them happen. And then when it comes to public relations, you'll hear from Mark about the magic dust he adds to the work that we do.
Well done to you.
Thank you.
That's good. Yeah, we'll speak.
I think Simon, Michael is somebody that you should get to know. You guys are both based in London. You should definitely get to know because Michael's an investor. You're marketing. You've got the story to tell. There's definitely a conversation or a lunch to be had there.
Amazing story as well.
Yeah, Michael's superb. Excellent. Back there in that, let's go for the lady in the back. And then I think I saw one other hand as well. Yep, we got Jay.
Hi, I'm Alessandra. I was pleased we had dinner together
yesterday. That's right,
Look, great presentation. What I love mostly is that instead of focusing on a great scalable idea, something which is pragmatic and unique, you focus on something which is very important, which is culture, irony, and uniqueness, which is the genius part of doing your business. So first of all, compliments. I see a lot of things like this, but that really made the day for me. My question to you is, how do you think can industries, for instance, like mine, which is textile and fashion, really be creative in another way? Because as you have shown to us, some of this advertising totally fixed on constant icons, which are very already upstyled, and mostly look at things which are boring from a cultural mindset. Which is your idea of the next things? Today, after the COVID, everybody of us wants to look at something inspiring in a different way than it was pre-COVID. Thanks.
Okay, well, I think that the key thing is to understand, you know, what you want to achieve and what your vision is, and then find a way of translating that into a creative idea that brings it to life, that motivates, excites people, and going back to that earlier point, the very first audience for any advertising has to be your own colleagues, staff, people you employ, who you want to employ, because those are the people who deliver the brand promise. And just to clarify why that first question was definitely a trick question and probably got most people confused, and which Byron Sharp talks about, is it's much more important to be distinctive than to focus on a point of differentiation that might be completely irrelevant to the customer. So go back to those watch ads, they all go, oh, well, we've got this, we've got that. But actually, what happens in competitive industries is that people try and differentiate through the detail and become more and more alike. So it's much better to do the opposite. And as a starting point, that's not a bad place to be, because then you stand out. And without standing out, people won't remember your name or remember what you're selling. And if they don't do that, they won't buy you when they are in the market.
Excellent. Okay, Jay, we got Jay, and then we're going to move on. All right, Jay.
Thank you very much, Michael. We heard two contrasting presentations today. In the morning, two very entrepreneurial people said, we spent zero on advertising, and they still grew so fast. And you are saying, obviously, advertising works, but targeted advertising. So how do you compare the two?
It's a good question. I mean, Miltos Camporides of Dolphin Capital Partners has made a very big business, and he says he's never never paid anyone to write anything about him.
Well, he is a developer and owner, and then what he does is he gets a company like One and Only, who spend a lot of money on advertising, to be the operations company that then has to get the customers in the door. So, yes, he doesn't spend money on advertising, but he uses a brand which does to do that job for him. So,
Word of mouth is the best advertising.
He's mentioning word of mouth. Isn't word of mouth the best?
It is, and therefore, what we look to do is to amplify the paid media so that, using the work that Mark does, so that the media writes about it, which you don't pay for, and which people share on social media. And, for example, you know, I was interviewed for the campaign that we created for ourselves three times on national television. That's unheard of for any sort of small B2B. I mean, we're targeting 3,000 people, yet we used TV and outdoor, got us onto national media, and it was the ability to then send that clip out on email to potential clients that was incredibly valuable. So that word of mouth thing only existed because we had paid for the advertising. So it's like a flywheel. You've got to get it spinning. And I'm sure Mark's going to take it on from there.
Excellent. Listen, Mickey Edison, we've got one last question there.
So when you develop a budget for an advertising campaign, how long do you judge, and when is the return to the company of the cost of that budget? How long does it take on efforts, and then when do you decide to pull it?
Well, the answer to that question is depending on where the company sits already with awareness or what it's trying to achieve and what the campaign's got to deliver. But there are two types of advertising. There's what we call the brand advertising, which works in the long term, and that's the bit that gets the company's name in your head when you're not even thinking about buying something that the company is selling. And then there's the advertising that sort of nudges you over the line when you're, you know, actively researching different car models, which one you're going to buy. You're in a much more rational mode. So the challenge that most advertisers have is that the sort of more tactical performance-related advertising is the one that they can measure directly to sales. And I have a personal beef about clients who say, we need to have a digital-first marketing strategy. So it's complete bollocks. What you need is a marketing strategy and then work out what digital does versus outdoor and television, because outdoor and television is what grows the brand, and it's that high-wastage media. And it's coming back to what somebody said this morning. It's about speed.
Yep. Yes.
So if you need to grow the brand quickly because you've got competitors on your tail or whatever else, you've got to do that big expenditure stuff that you can't directly relate to the performance-related marketing. And the danger of the digital-first-only approach is it's a bit like a football manager who looks at all the different performances of the team and works out that as forwards are the people who score the goal, he hires only forwards and loses every single match. So what's called last click attribution, you need a football team to kick the ball up the field, which does involve stuff that isn't so directly measurable on sales. So there's a bit of a Hail Mary element to it as well.
Excellent. Listen, Michael, thank you so much. We're going to keep on inviting you back because you just keep on teaching us all sorts of interesting things and unlocking insights in our own brains and so forth. Thank you very much for coming back to Mykonos. Thank you.
My pleasure.
All right.